Welcome to In the Desert of Set, a pagan and occult website by G.B. Marion. I'm G.B. Marion. I write about life as a polytheist in contemporary times with random, long-winded detours into ancient history, classic horror movies, and all kinds of other fun stuff. Won't you join me for today's adventure?
If you'd like to read a free electronic print copy of the following recording, please visit desertofset.com.
Gorgo, the Irish feminist sea dragon. In Gorgo from 1961, two guys named Sam and Joe are traveling the British seas looking for gold and other precious junk on the ocean floor. Their ship gets damaged during a weird volcanic eruption that happens in the middle of the sea for no apparent reason, and they end up having to stay on an island off the coast of Ireland for a few days. While repairing their ship, Sam and Joe notice that the people of this island seem to be hiding something. Well, that something turns out to be a giant bipedal lizard with big floppy fins for ears. Sam and Joe decide to capture the creature, and when they do, the Irish government implores them to give the beast to the University of Dublin for scientific research. Unfortunately, our protagonists decide to bring the reptile to Dorkin's Circus in London instead, where they make a shit ton of money off the poor creature. The joke's on them, though, because they soon learn that Gorgo, the name Dorkin gives to the creature, which is taken from the three Gorgons in Greek mythology, is not the only one of its breed. It's really just a baby, in fact, and its mother, who is significantly larger and meaner, is now on her way to file one hell of a grievance against the entire city of London. That's pretty much the entire plot to the film right there, and considering its year of release, we're dealing with some pretty predictable stuff. For the most part, Gorgo is largely a remake of King Kong from 1933, save that its giant monster is of the Saurian persuasion. Yet there are several things that distinguish this kaiju film from all of its contemporaries. At the most obvious level, it's not Japanese but British, and it provides some interesting insight into the United Kingdom's socio-political situation at the time. When Sam and Joe arrive at the island with their crew, they seek help from the Irish locals, but the locals will only respond to them in Gaelic, even though they clearly understand English. Sam and Joe also learn the harbor master has been salvaging archaeological finds from the ocean, and they bully the dude into giving him all of his loot as quote-unquote payment for capturing Gorgo. Later on, when they decide to sell Gorgo to the London Circus, they are effectively giving the Irish government the middle finger. That's not once, but twice in the same film, where Ireland gets screwed over by Anglo-Saxons who robbed the Gaels not only of their history in the form of their archaeological treasures, but of their very own real-life dragon as well. I first saw Gorgo when I was 5 or 6 years old. I had already seen a lot of giant monster flicks by that point, and in most of them, the quote-unquote ethnic people are usually people of color, or white and or Japanese people in blackface or brownface. This goes all the way back to King Kong, which unfortunately depicts black people as savages whom the white characters could easily exploit. But Gorgo was the first of these movies I ever saw where it's white people treating other white people this way. Seeing Englishmen mistreat Irish people and animals in Gorgo was my introduction to subjects like hibernophobia and the Troubles of Northern Ireland. I also love the film for being my first exposure to Gaelic language and culture. But there is another subtext in this film. So there's this Irish kid named Sean, and he's the only character who sympathizes with the monsters at first. He even stows away on Sam and Joe's ship, hoping to free baby Gorgo out at sea. The kid gets caught, but what do you think happens after that? Well, Sam and Joe decide to let Sean live with them, that's what. And yes, I said with them. With only a few brief exceptions, these two men spend the entire movie together. And the body language they use around each other at home is most interesting. There is one scene where Sam and Joe are comforting little Sean while he tries to go to sleep. And Joe stands at the head of the bed in a typical fatherly pose, while Sam sits beside Sean on the mattress in a more gentle and nurturing pose. Then there's another scene where Sam and Joe squabble over a carnival worker who has been killed by Baby Gorgo. Sam is worried about the guy's wife and kids, and Joe, not wanting Sam to worry, promises he will send the family some money. There's even a scene where the two of them are introduced as Joe Ryan and his partner, Sam Slade. And while that kind of terminology didn't have the same connotation in 1961 that it has today, it's hard not to imbue it with contemporary significance. It's also interesting that there isn't a single girl or woman in the entire cast, and that when one of the adult characters finally starts to side with Sean about setting Baby Gorgo free, it's Sam, the quote-unquote motherly father. In other words, it's totally believable to me that Sam and Joe are a couple, that they've adopted Sean, and that the three of them have become a family. I say Gorgo has no women in it, aside from a few here or there among the extras during the final act, but there is at least one female in the film, if not two, and that's Mama Gorgo. It's never specifically confirmed at any point that she's got a double X pair of sex chromosomes, but I think we can safely assume that this is true. How else can we explain Baby Gorgo? And if you're wondering where the father might be, well, there are such things as the New Mexico whiptail, a lizard species that is entirely female and that reproduces through parthenogenesis. It seems likely to me that Baby Gorgo is female as well, given that Dorkins names her after the Gorgons of Greek mythology, all of whom are ladies. Gorgo was also the name of a famous queen of Sparta who lived and ruled during the 6th and 5th centuries BCE, so any way you slice it, it would seem that the giant lizards and Gorgo are the only female characters in this entire movie. This would make sense in light of certain combat myths like the Enuma Elish, for just as Marduk used his masculine strength to slay his Saurian mother Tiamat and create the universe from her corpse, so too do Sam and Joe try to create a multi-million dollar empire with the female Irish sea dragon they've captured. But things don't go quite so well for them as they did for old Marduk. Which brings us to why I think Gorgo is something more than just a King Kong cash-in. I've always found the original 1933 King Kong too horrific to watch, because it's about people committing acts of animal cruelty and not having to pay any real consequences for doing so. While many viewers sympathize with the titular giant ape, there is no indication in the film itself that we're actually supposed to. Kong is presented as being just a big dumb animal who has to die so the damsel in distress can live to marry the dashing male hero. None of the characters mourn for Kong, and no one acknowledges that removing him from his natural environment and exploiting him was wrong, or at least not until the remakes came along. Such was the general attitude audiences had toward giant monsters until 1954, when Eiichiro Honda gave us the original Godzilla. The monster in that film also had to die, but its death was treated more like a funeral. The audience is actively encouraged to sympathize with it and to consider the aftermath of all the violence that happens in the film. Gorgo, in contrast, is the first kaiju film in which the monsters are not only sympathetic but victorious. There's nothing quite so satisfying as seeing Mama and Baby Gorgo swimming back home to Ireland at the end of the film. And it wasn't long after their victory that Mothra, Godzilla, King Kong, and the giant turtle Gamera were each reimagined as kid-friendly superheroes. So the conflict in this film would seem to exist between two different same-sex families. On the one hand, a single mother and her little girl, the Gorgos, and on the other hand, two men and their son, Sam, Joe, and Sean. Neither of these two families is normal according to traditional patriarchal standards, and yet the film never tries to punish either of them for this. As mentioned earlier, the Gorgos are reunited and get to go home, alive and happy. But even the human family turns out okay in the end. They also share a collective character arc. At first it's just Sam and Joe, and all they care about is fame and money. Then they adopt Sean, and Sam starts sympathizing with the Gorgos like Sean does. Joe, the quote-unquote fatherly dad, remains an asshole for most of the story, but then redeems himself during Mama Gorgo's attack on London. He protects Sean amidst all the destruction, and they are both safely reunited with Sam at the end. Based on how Joe behaves earlier in the film, you would expect this character to try and save his own skin while leaving the kid alone to die, and then be promptly eaten by the monster himself for being a dick. Not so with Joe. He sees the light, chooses his kid over his own self-preservation, and actually works hard to be a good dad. You almost never see this kind of character transition in giant monster movies, especially in the 1960s, and to think Joe is a gay man just makes it cooler. Gorgo does have its flaws, but most of them are the kind I tend to overlook. The writing isn't as sharp as it could have been. Most of the character development is restricted to the first two acts, which tends to bore the hell out of most viewers, while most of the action occurs during the final act, at which point the film forgets its human characters almost entirely. These things don't really bother me. The only serious criticism I have about Gorgo is the fact that during its final 18 minutes, it suddenly introduces a news reporter character who narrates every single detail about Mama Gorgo's parade through London. This segment is so glaringly unnecessary, it's virtually impossible for me to ignore it. The first 60 minutes of this story are easy enough to follow, so why the hell did anyone think the last 18 needed a goddamn narrator? But another thing I love about Gorgo is the fact that it makes me think about Tewerit, the hippo fertility goddess. Tewerit is like a benign chaos monster. Instead of being killed to save or create the world, she kills other monsters that threaten the future of the world. Mama Gorgo is a perfect cinematic avatar for Tewerit, and watching this film is kind of like watching the great female crush the white racist capitalist patriarchy beneath her cute stubby toes. Seeing this movie as a kid probably helped put me on Tewerit's wavelength even back then. If you're pagan and you love animals, especially gigantic reptilian beasties with wiggly ears, I bet dollars to donuts you will enjoy Gorgo. If you've never seen it and you'd like an additional bonus to go along with it, this movie is featured in Episode 9 from Season 9 of Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Thank you so much for listening. If you enjoyed this sermon and you'd like to read some more, please check out desertofset.com. I hope you have a wonderful day. Set bless.